أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد. Dear Muslims, if you look at the Quranic discourse about the qalb, the heart, one finds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the reality of the heart and the stages of the heart and the different types of heart in so many verses. In today's brief khutbah, I want to shed some light about some of the Quranic realities of the qalb. Because if you look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the qalb, for example, Allah azza wa jal mentions one type of qalb, which is the best type of qalb, and that is the qalb salim, the pure heart. Allah says, on the day of judgment, nothing will help anybody. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ Neither your wealth, nor your power, nor your children, nothing will benefit you. What will benefit you on the day of judgment? The one who comes to Allah with a good heart. The good heart will benefit. Notice how Allah describes this. In another verse, Allah mentions about those who reject Islam, that طَبَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ Their hearts have been covered up. In another verse, عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ غِشَاوَةً Their hearts have a seal. In another verse, خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ Allah has locked their hearts. Look, locking, sealing. In yet another verse, كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ Their hearts are rusting. What is this rusting of the heart, locking of the heart, sealing of the heart? What is this pure heart? And yet another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, describing the believers, ثُمَّ تَلِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ Their hearts become soft at the dhikr of Allah. So you have the hard heart, you have the soft heart, you have the sealed heart, you have the covered heart, you have the pure heart. Look at all these different hearts. So here the question arises, what then is the state of your heart? And how should your heart and my heart be? Again, only so much can be given in one khutbah. But the point I want to really cause us to think about is, just like there is a physical heart that is important for the body, there is a spiritual qalb that is important for the soul. You know, the most important organ of the body is the qalb. We know this, right? If your heart is good in the physical sense, then generally speaking, the rest of your body is going to be good. If your heart is not good, then subhanAllah, it doesn't matter the rest of the body, khalas, there's nothing that can be done. The heart is the most important organ. We all know this. Similarly, for the soul, the qalb is the most important. For the spirituality, it is the qalb. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this explicitly in the hadith. He said in the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, أَلَا إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَى إِذَا صَلُحَتْ صَلُحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبِ He said there's one organ. There's one organ in the body. If that organ is good, the whole body is good. And if that organ is bad, the whole body is bad. Pause here. This hadith, it applies in the physical sense and in the spiritual sense. This is the beauty of the kalam of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's speaking in the medicinal, physical, and he's also speaking in the spiritual, in the reality of being prophethood. So, in the physical sense, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, if your heart is good, alhamdulillah, generally your body will be good. And in the spiritual sense, if the spiritual qalb is good, then generally the rest of your iman will also be good. So, my point today, or one of the main points I want for us to think about, Just like when we do our annual checkup, we go and do the annual checkup. The first thing the doctor checks is what? He checks your heart, he checks your pulse, he checks your blood pressure, he listens to the qalb. This is the first thing that the doctor does. So I remind myself and you, when was the last time we did a spiritual checkup of our qalb? When was the last time we checked the state of our qalb? Because the qalb, the spiritual qalb, is much more important than the physical qalb. Wallahi, this is the case. Why? Because the physical qalb, how long will it last? How long will we live? It's all of us, our lives are finite. Every one of us will return to Allah. The physical qalb, it is temporary. But the spiritual qalb, that is what will dictate our eternal akhirah. The spiritual qalb, that is what is really going to decide the fate of our eternal life. So here we are, so obsessed with the physical qalb. Here we are, monitoring our blood pressure, monitoring our cholesterol, monitoring this and that, which is good. I'm not saying we shouldn't do that. But 100 times more important, a million times more important, monitoring the spiritual qalb. And when was the last time we even bothered to check up on our spiritual qalb? When Allah is telling us, we have so many different types of qulub, so many different types of hearts, and Allah wants us to have what type of qalb? Qalb salim. Allah wants us to have the good heart, the pure heart. Allah wants us to have what type of qalb? The qalb, the qalb that is soft. Talinu qulubuhum. Their hearts are soft-hearted. Allah does not want us to have hard hearts. Allah Azza wa Jal curses those who have hearts caused. La'annahum waja'alna qulubahum khashi'a. We curse them and we made their hearts hard-hearted. A'udhu billah. Allah's la'na is on those whose hearts are hard. We don't want to have hard hearts. We don't want to have sealed hearts. We don't want to have rusted hearts. And most and worst of all, we don't want to have locked and chained hearts. Allahu ala qulubihim. We don't want to have locked and sealed and shut. No. So, today's khutbah then, how do we monitor the heart? What is the blood pressure? What is the stethoscope that we're going to put to figure out what is the spiritual state of the qalb? Number one. And number two, once we analyze, then what do we do to get a better qalb? Because in the physical sense, the doctor will tell you, exercise more. The doctor will tell you, monitor your cholesterol. The doctor will tell you, don't eat sweets, don't do this and that. Eat good, exercise healthy. This is the physical qalb. What is the spiritual equivalent? What is the counterdote for when your spiritual qalb is battling? What do we do? In brief, sisters and brothers, in brief, one of the ways to monitor the state of the qalb, there are many ways. One of the ways, one of the most important, you can call this the blood pressure. The equivalent of the spiritual blood pressure is the following. Ask yourself, how often do I do dhikr and think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is the spiritual pulse of the qalb. The more powerful your qalb is, the healthier your qalb is, then the pulse will be stronger. And what is, I say the pulse is? The pulse is the dhikr of Allah. The pulse is remembering Allah. The pulse is contemplating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more you are thinking of Allah, that is literally what dhikr Allah is. The more you are reflective of Allah, the more spiritually strong your heart is. And the less you think of Allah, well, that is a danger. That is your weak blood pressure. That is, the doctor cannot feel a pulse. Where is the pulse? Because you are not doing what needs to be done. Another mechanism to monitor the spiritual state of your qalb. So there are a number of litmus tests, right? One of them is you monitor and you see, how often do I think of Allah and do dhikr? Another symptom of a qalb, a healthy versus a sick. How do you know? Do you find satisfaction and pleasure in the worship of Allah? Do you find spiritual fulfillment in your salah? Do you enjoy listening to the Quran? Do you find comfort when you're surrounded by people of piety? Or, wal-iyadu billah, we seek Allah's refuge. The prayer is a chore and you don't like doing it. Because that is the symptom of a diseased heart, sisters and brothers. Wallahi, it is a diseased heart. If the salah becomes a nuisance, an irritation, if you don't like listening to the Quran, if you don't like being in the company of the pious people, then this is a symptom that there is a bigger problem, and that problem is inside of you. That problem is right here. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in the Quran, with regards to the munafiqun, the worst category of mankind, the lowest of the low, Allah says, وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَى. When they stand up to pray, they stand up and they are lazy. They don't want to pray. They don't want to pray. يُرَعُونَ النَّاسِ. They're doing it because they have to do it. They're doing it because they want to show off. Subhanallah, when our Prophet ﷺ was under stress, was under pressure, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha says, whenever something troubled the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he had a difficult day, when he was surrounded by stress and tension, what would he do? Pause here, what do we do? What do I do? What do you do? We just log on to the internet. We plop in front of the sofa and turn on the television. We find comfort that way. How did the Prophet do it? Our mother Aisha radiallahu anha says, he would rush to stand up in salah. When he was troubled, when he had a difficult day, what would bring him comfort? He said in the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. The comfort of my soul has been made in the salah. I find comfort and peace when I stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, obviously, this is the highest of the high, and the lowest of the lows, you hate salah. In the middle are most of us. We know we have to pray, and we pray, and we're happy we pray. There's nothing wrong with that. But I'm going to be honest here. If you don't find comfort in salah, if you're not rejuvenated in salah, then this is a sign the heart is not as healthy as it needs to be. Many of us, most of us, we pray and we're happy, we pray, alhamdulillah, that's good. That's the sign the heart is alive, at least we're praying. But I'm saying honestly, if we don't find happiness in our sajdas, if we don't find the sakina coming in, this means we have some work to do. Because salah should bring comfort. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. The highest form of dhikr is the salah. And the salah is done, and one finds comfort in it when one's heart is good. So these are two basic symptoms of how you know your spiritual state. How much are you thinking of Allah, number one? And number two, what is the state of your own spirituality when you're worshipping? Do you find comfort? Do you look forward to the salah and the Quran and religiosity? Or are you turned away from it? So there are other symptoms as well, but time is limited, so let us move on. When we look at the physical qalb, the doctors will tell you, number one cause of bad heart is you're not exercising and you're eating unhealthy food, right? So what is the equivalent in the spiritual side? What is the number one cause of the spiritual qalb going on the decline? The number one cause of your qalb going down is that a person does not care about the sharia of Allah in their lives. They don't care about applying the sharia of Allah. They don't wonder what is haram, what is halal. They're not bothered, is my rizq halal or haram? They're not bothered, is my food halal or haram? They're not bothered, is my lifestyle halal and haram? It's simply gone from their lives. They do what they please. The halal is what they want, and the haram is what they don't want. This is the number one cause of the weakening of the heart. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَبِمَا نَقْضِهِمْ مِيثَاقَهُمْ وَكُفْرِهِمْ بِآتِ اللَّهِ. Because they broke the commandment of Allah, لَعَنَّاهُمْ وَجَعَلْنَا قُلُوبَهُمْ قَاسِيَةً. Because they broke the commandments of Allah, فَبِمَا نَقْضِهِمْ مِيثَاقَهُمْ. They didn't follow Allah's commands. They didn't follow haram and halal. They didn't care about the lifestyle they should live. Allah says that we cursed them. He's talking about another group of people. We cursed them and we made their hearts hard. Notice how Allah causally linked. They didn't follow the laws. They didn't follow the sharia. If we want to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we want to have a good qalb, then we monitor with our lifestyles, with our daily routine. Am I living my life according to the sharia of Allah? Is my values, my ethics, my judgment, my waking, my sleeping? قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. How Islamic is my entire life? And if you find that your lifestyle is un-Islamic, don't be surprised. This is going to lead to high cholesterol. It's going to lead to weak heart. It's going to lead to bad blood pressure. This is exactly what we're doing. When a person does not care about one's physical lifestyle, the qalb is going to be affected. Similarly, when one does not care about the spiritual lifestyle, the spiritual qalb will be affected. And again, other things can be said, but time is limited. The final point, inshallah ta'ala, for the first khutbah. The final point. So when you go to the doctor, you have a weak heart, whatever, the doctor will say, khalas, that's it. You're going to have to stop all of this bad food. You're going to have to get into healthy exercise. He's going to give you the routine, what needs to be done. Similarly, on the spiritual side, what is the routine? If you self-acknowledge, if you see for yourself, my qalb is weak, my spirituality is low, then what is the regiment that must be prescribed? the number one regiment that must be prescribed for the heart to become stronger is to increase in the quality and quantity of your adhkar. To increase in the quality and quantity of your dhikr of Allah. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ Verily, through the dhikr of Allah will the hearts find tranquility and peace. Now, dhikr doesn't just mean Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Akbar. This is one type of dhikr. In reality, dhikr encompasses anything that reminds you of Allah. The Quran is the ultimate dhikr. Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ ذِكْرًا We have sent down the dhikr. Allah calls the Qur'an dhikr. The Qur'an is the ultimate dhikr. Dua is a type of dhikr. Salah is dhikr. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِ The ultimate action of dhikr is salah. So dhikr doesn't just mean that you sit with the tasbih and say, La ilaha illallah, subhanallah. That is one type of dhikr. And that's healthy and good. But all actions of worship, reciting the Qur'an, and praying salah, and being involved in anything that reminds you of Allah, it comes under dhikr. And Allah says explicitly that the righteous are those who their hearts become soft through the dhikr of Allah. That تلين قلوبهم جلودهم وقلوبهم إلى ذكر الله. Allah links the softening of the heart, the purity of the heart. Allah links it to the concept of dhikr. This is explicit in the Quran. And of course, other things can be said here, but for today's khutbah, we'll only mention this one point. So, if you analyze yourself, that your heart needs to get a boost, your heart needs to get a strengthening, then one of the most important, no, the most important way to strengthen one's own heart is to increase the quality and the quantity of dhikr. And this means salah, this means Quran, and this means, yes, the adhkar, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, walhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. These are the four adhkar that are the queen of all other adhkar. So many adhkar are mentioned in the Quran and Sunnah, but the queens of them, the ones that all other adhkar go back to, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Say these adhkar, read the Quran, be involved in your salah, and you will find your heart will slowly but surely, inevitably begin to enjoy the worship of Allah. Your heart will become softer, your life will become filled with meaning and purpose. You will attain an inner tranquility. And this is of the greatest blessings of having a good qalb. When your heart is strong, when your heart is spiritually high, then alhamdulillah, life becomes worth living. Life becomes noble. You find a sense of sakina and tama'nina, a sense of tranquility that nothing will bring you. And most importantly, when you live your life with a spiritually pure heart, this is ensuring that in the akhirah, you will live the eternally pure life. On that day, Allah says in the Quran, nothing will benefit you except the one who comes with qalb salim. So we want qalb salim. We want to have the good heart. We want to have the best heart. The only way to guarantee we'll have qalb salim on the day of judgment is to die with the qalb salim in this world. That's the only way. You cannot attain qalb salim in the qabr. You cannot change your heart in the akhirah. So we need to work on the spiritual qalb right here and now. We need to start emphasizing our spirituality. Come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make sure our qalbs are soft. There's no rust on it. There's no hardness of the heart. Make sure we purify the heart. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا The one who purifies the heart is the one who will be successful. This is in the Quran. The only way to be successful is tazkiyatul qalb. There's no other way. So let us begin purifying the qalb now so that on the day of judgment we will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't need wealth. We don't need children. That's not going to benefit us. What will benefit us? The one who comes with qalb salim. Barakallahu wa lakum furqanan azim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bima fihi min ayati wa dhikri al-hakim aqulu ma tasma'un wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum wa li sa'il muslimin kulli dhanbin fastaghfiru innahu wal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله الواحد الأحد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد وبعد. Dear Muslims, one other point before we make dua and finish our khutbah for today. SubhanAllah, there's so much happening in the ummah right now. And here we are, Allah has blessed us to live in a land of relative peace, of comfort. Allah has given us every amenity we can want for. وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If we could count the blessings of Allah, Allah says, if you try to count the blessings that I have given you, you cannot even count them. When Allah has given us so many blessings, and yet we look around the world, and our brothers and sisters around the world, and especially right now in Gaza and Palestine, but not just there, everywhere we look, subhanAllah, there is a wound, there is a bleeding taking place. We are one ummah, we are one body. It is as if we have been stabbed in so many places. And yes, right now, the worst stabbing that is affecting us the most is that in Gaza and Palestine. But around the world, what is happening amongst the Uyghurs, what is happening amongst so many, if I mention any countries, somebody is going to come and say, you forgot that country. That's the state we are in. I don't want to start a long list because otherwise we cannot even finish. But subhanAllah, my message to me and you is very simple. How can we not be affected? How can we not have a sense of compassion, a sense of relationship? We are one ummah. And honest, blunt question, I don't want to offend anybody, but the fact of the matter is, it is Allah's blessing me and you are sitting here and not over there. I didn't choose where I was born. I didn't choose my life. Allah chose it for me. Allah blessed me. If Allah had willed, you and I would have been born on the other side of the wall in Gaza. You know this. If Allah had willed, we would have been brought up in a concentration camp. We would have been brought up in an open air prison. But Allah blessed us to be over here. So with that blessing, we thank Allah. But with that blessing comes what? Responsibility. With that privilege comes what? Responsibility. So if Allah has blessed us to have these freedoms, to have these luxuries, well then, even more incumbent on us that we do something to thank Allah for these blessings, that we demonstrate to Allah that we are truly thankful for all that He has given us. And there are so many people, they're not even able to worship Allah in peace. Do you understand how many millions of Muslims would love to be where you are right now, to be able to pray 5 times a day, to be able to worship Allah in peace, to be able to raise their families? Allah has given this to me and you on a silver platter. I didn't ask for it. I didn't ask where I was born. Allah gave it to me. Allah gifted me and you without asking. And Allah gave us all of these blessings. How then? How can we have such a hard heart that we turn away from the plight of the ummah and don't care about them? How can we not demonstrate thankfulness to Allah in all that we do? And so what are some of the ways to demonstrate that thankfulness? First and foremost, in your own personal life, make sure you are striving to have the excellence, the highest level. How can people are being tortured because of their kalima? In China, they're not allowed to pray 5 times a day. They're in concentration camps. Muslims are not allowed to practice Islam. How can we see this and then have the luxury to practice Islam and not practice Islam? It is a shame, wallahi, I'm sorry to be blunt here. It is a shame. We have all of these freedoms and we are not taking advantage by worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi, our brothers and sisters would love to be here so that they can pray. And yet here we are, the dunya, 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 we're not even praying regularly. So point number one, in your personal life, make sure you are the best of the best. Be the best you can be in your business, in your engineering, in your medicine, but be the best Muslim as well. Be the best you can be in the deen and dunya, combine them together. This is point number one. Point number two, do not ignore the plights of the people around. Give public awareness to them. Raise in a wise manner. Nobody's saying be unwise. There are laws, there are controversies. Be wise, but raise public awareness. Be active. Be a part of the process of change. Bring about a whole intellectual revolution. People don't understand what's happening there. It's your job and my job to educate, to teach. So learn what is happening. And then lobby, rally, campaign, public awareness. And then point number three, last but definitely not least, nothing trivial in this regard. Make dua for them wherever possible. Fundraise and give something. Allah has given us so much, a little bit of percentage of wealth to help the people around the world. Support these causes so that on the day of judgment we can say, oh Allah, I couldn't change the whole situation, but I did what I could. Oh Allah, I'm not in charge of everything. I can't just snap my fingers and solve the Palestinian problem. But I made dua for them. I lobbied for them. I changed public awareness for them. I gave whatever I could. Whatever small things you do, inshallah, that is where Allah's blessings will come. We're not being asked to change the whole world. We are being asked to change ourselves. We're being asked to change our family and friends, to impact our community. If we do so, if every one of us did so, what would happen? SubhanAllah, sisters and brothers, so much can be said here. But I have to mention one point. Here. I just found out today, mashallah, tabarakallah, your community in this city is 10% of this city. This is a statistic that is mind-boggling. As somebody who travels the world, somebody who is very active across the hemisphere, for Toronto to have 10% Muslims, 10%. Do you understand? 1 out of 10 people in the greater city is of our faith tradition. Wallahi, Allah has blessed you. Yet that 1%, that 10% is not seeming to be effective. How come the masses don't understand the Palestinian conflict properly? How come we're not having a bigger impact on our society? I think the issue is we need to be more involved. We need to be more engaged. We need to show who we are and show people of our faith. So Allah has blessed you. Allah has given you so much. Take advantage of those blessings. Rise to meet your potential. Be the best you can be in the dunya, no problem. But also be the best you can be in the deen. Be a role model Muslim. Be an activist. Be somebody who embodies the prophetic message, so that when your colleagues, when your friends, when your neighbors see you, they see the beauty of Islam. Do what you can with whatever you have. And if you do so on the Day of Judgment, you would have done everything Allah wants you to do. You can earn the highest place of Jannah just being the best you can be. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of us to rise to that level and grant us qalbin saleem. Allahumma ni da'in fa aminu. Allahumma la tad'a fi hadhihi al-yawmi dhamman illa ghafarta, wa la hamman illa farajta, wa la daynan illa qadayta, wa la maridan illa شفيت ولا عسيرا إلا يسرت. اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم من أرادنا أو أراد الإسلام والمسلمين بسوء فاشغله بنفسه وجعل تدميره في تدبيره يا قوي يا عزيز. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ به بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه وثلث بكم أيها المؤمنون من جنه وإنسه، فقال عز من قائل عليما: إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك رسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه يزد لكم، ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر. وأقم الصلاة.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If I can just ask everybody to be patient for a couple of minutes. There's a sister who would like to express her shahada and embrace Islam. And Brother Abdul Mateen also has a couple of announcements, inshallah. So please, we ask you for a couple of minutes of your patience. So the sister is Rubina Ainuddin, and she is embracing Islam today. She's upstairs with the sisters. So I'm going to request the sister to kindly repeat after me in Arabic and then in English. And then inshallah, Brother Abdul Mateen will read the announcements, inshallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasul Allah. Okay, we're going to ask you to repeat after me. I bear witness and testify that there's only one God, Allah. I also bear witness and testify that Muhammad is God's final messenger. Takbir. May the Almighty bless this sister who has just embraced Islam. We welcome you to the community. And if there's anything that we can assist or help with, please do feel free to stay in touch with the Islamic Foundation of Toronto. Once again, we're very appreciative of Dr. Yasir Qadhi, who has given us the Jummah service today. May Allah bless him and honor him. We also appreciate the partnership with Reviving the Islamic Spirit. The Shaykh is actually here for the conference, so please do attend his lectures and sessions in the conference, inshallah. Brothers and sisters who are appointed for the line collection can do so while Brother Abdul Mateen reads the announcements. Thank you. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Very briefly and very quickly, last Friday the collection was $2,878. Jazakumullah khairan for your ongoing generosity, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all. As been mentioned already, with the ongoing tragedies occurring in Palestine and in Gaza, we are continuing to raise funds as we have been for the better part of the last 2.5 months. So please continue to donate generously, inshallah, to donate towards the relief and shelter, food, water, and other medicines that are urgently required by our brothers and sisters over there. As Shaykh mentioned, the reviving the Islamic spirit is taking place from today all the way to Sunday. And our visiting scholar here, Shaykh Yasir Qadhi, is one of the keynote speakers. He'll be presenting today as well as tomorrow. Please visit the website risconvention.com. And lastly, there is a janazah today for Sister Bilqis Begum Haider. The burial will be at Pine Ridge Memorial Gardens, which is at 1757 Church Street North in Ajax. Inshallah, maps can be taken from the office. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the deceased with Jannatul Firdaus and forgive her shortcomings. Ameen. Shaykh Yasir Qadhi will be doing the janazah salah, inshallah, immediately after Salatul Jummah, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
لا إله إلا الله استوى اعتدلوا الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين أولم يروا أنا خلقنا لهم مما عملت أيدينا أنعاما فهم لها مالكون وذللناها لهم فمنها ركوبهم ومنها يأكلون ولهم فيها منافع ومشارب أفلا يشكرون واتخذوا من دون الله آلهة لعلهم ينصرون لا يستطيعون نصرهم وهم لهم جند محضرون فلا يحزنك قولهم إنا نعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون أولم يرى الإنسان أنا خلقناه من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين وضرب لنا مثلا ونسي خلقه قال من يحيي العظام وهي رميم قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم الذي جعل لكم من الشجر الأخضر نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون أوليس الذي خلق السماوات والأرض بقادر على أن يخلق مثلهم بلى وهو الخلاق العليم إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئاً أن يقول له كن فيكون فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء وإليه ترجعون
الله أكبر
سمع الله لمن حمده
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث
الله أكبر
سمع الله لمن حمده
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله لا إله إلا الله So brothers and sisters, inshallah, we are performing Salatul Janazah for deceased.